and it's live. Comcast Channel 22 or Verizon Channel 33. Check www.rctv.org for more information and for replay times. Our administrator, Chuck Tarone, is not available today, so I will be playing Chuck and Rebecca Longley. The first item on the agenda is the continued notice of intent, 270-0669, Lot 4, Kylie Drive, Map 34, Lot 143, Dahadwala. I think I'm going to have to talk slowly because we have another 10 minutes for the next item, and they've actually postponed until the November 9th. Meeting.
So there's no revised plans or no revised?
There was a revised plan. I'll just give you a slight highlight. I know I'm not supposed to talk about it probably, but it seemed that they took the driveway out of the
buffer?
The easement. No,
yep, the easement.
The easement. There is a stone wall. Now this is subject to change because, you know, Chuck took the new plans away, so I couldn't give them to you. They may change. There were some native plantings in like one of the 5 foot, I think, is the easement 10 feet?
10 feet wide.
Yeah. 10 feet wide. In one location, as it comes down closer towards Charles Street, coming down that slope, they put in about 5 feet of natural vegetation and then narrowed the trail to about 5 feet. But this is a continuation. And then a little sliver on the other side, they put in some natural vegetation as well, you know, near that detention basin and back at that house, not part of this. They do have, remember where they had that pool in the equipment for the pool? I don't know if that's on posts, but that looks to hang over into the 35 foot no structure zone. But they've done all kinds of native plantings in back. And I think they rectified the distance for the pool. I'm not sure. But we'll know next meeting, correct?
Okay.
Just so that, has everybody signed into the sign-in sheet in the back?
I will sign in.
Yes, please.
Okay.
Okay. Gee, I taught you folks well.
Where is it?
It's the yellow
lined
paper.
Yeah.
High tech. That's all I had.
It's good enough. It works.
Yeah. Is there anything we can talk about? Think so.
Could you talk about the enforcement on 582 Summer? I wasn't.
They are going to come.
Give me a brief background. Is there one?
Yes.
Okay.
It's not brief. It
okay.
has a lot to do with me. I noticed a lot of noise on Summer Avenue.
Oh, is this something that we discussed
last week?
Yeah.
Well,
was it something that you also mentioned?
I think you'd mentioned it the time before or something. You mentioned it once before.
I had noticed some noise.
Yep, got it.
And I thought it was on the uphill side of Bear Hill, but when I drove my car past, I noticed a ginormous crane on the downhill side of Summer Ave, you know, four houses up from myself.
Right.
And I know that I have wetlands in back, so I did call Chuck. He went out and talked to the owner. Well, the owner wasn't there, but the two companies that were doing the work, they found that they had cut several trees beyond our jurisdiction, but there were two trees that had been cut down. I think one a pine tree that may have had some rotting limbs, and then another, I don't know if it was green ash, can't remember. Do you remember what I had said? I don't know. It's a mature tree. And that one I don't know, I don't think that that was in poor health.
Okay.
So we had discussed, you know, we would like the opportunity for the arborist, not the arborist, but the tree person, who is also lives on Summer Avenue down the street from me. The other one was up the street from me.
Small neighborhood.
Yeah, and he's done work for me, and I know him personally. So I had called him. He came over, and we talked about, you know, what he should be doing as, you know, a tree person for his clients, to let them know that there may be permits involved, and that if there's any question, you can go on our GIS, take a look at our wetlands maps, or call Chuck and let them know. So I think I did call Dave today. He's working tonight.
Was an enforcement order issued?
Yes, two.
Okay.
One to the owner and one to Mr. Costello, who is the tree person.
What were the terms? To replace trees? To come in and meet? To come up with a plan?
We had Chuck and I discussed this at length, and Chuck actually had gone down and talked to them. And we decided to do an enforcement order, but the gist of it is we'd like at least for the tree person to come in, and we really want to tell him, you know, to educate him.
Right.
And so that he will, you know, notify his clients. You know,
okay.
You know, he's saying, well, it's up to the client, you know, the homeowner, to get the permit. Well, you got to let them know that there may be permits. I think there's a disconnect there. And we had talked about fines, but we, as a group, we kind of wanted...
At this point, we want to see if they come in.
The owner is supposed to come in tonight, and I told Dave today that he's working again tonight, he's filling in, and I said, can you come to the next meeting on the 9th? He says, yeah, put it on us, and I'll keep reminding him.
Okay.
Do we need to continue Fairly Drive?
Yes, we do. I'd like... Would somebody make a motion?
Make a motion to continue notice of intent 270-0669, Fairly Drive.
I'll second.
All those in favor? Okay.
Got two more minutes here.
Thank you.
Did everybody sign in to the... Okay, great. Thank you.
Is there any minutes from...
No.
14th?
Okay.
Not that I... What about site visit?
No.
Court? Just... Okay. I'm just trying to...
Do we have a...
Be productive.
DEP number for Randall Road?
We'll ask. Mr. Erickson's here.
Yeah. Okay. Just trying to stay ahead of the...
Doing
my job.
Make our agenda 2 minutes.
This is like...
2 to 5 minutes?
This is like doing laundry at home. No reward for doing a good job. Every guy I know that's ever gotten married, I tell them, first thing you do, put all the white clothes in the washing machine on hot and throw a brand new red sweater in here. You'll never have to do laundry again.
Now that is sound advice.
We're on
so
TV, you know.
I'm going to spell everything wrong. And
All right. Being 7:10, we can open. Steve, do we have a DEP number?
We have a DEP number. Yep.
What is that?
We also have some comments. They want additional information on the wetland application.
What am I missing?
Far left. 270-673.
Well, that makes sense.
That's why I can't. Ooh.
My street is at 672.
Okay.
Thank you.
Are these new plans?
These are, they just colored them.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
All right.
They're the same plan.
I can share these.
Okay, the public hearing for Randall Road Extension, map 10, 15 lots, 295, 56, 5678, Paul, notice of intent 270-063, is now open and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended in the general Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. Hearing is conducted in the following manner. The applicant will present the proposal. The commission will receive reports from the town advisors, being none. The commission will address questions and comments to the applicant, and the public will be given the opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, which should be directed to the chair, and give your name and address before your comments. At this time, I'd like to introduce the members of the Conservation Commission, starting on my left.
Michael Flynn.
Anika Scanlon, Vice Chair.
Rebecca Longley, Chair.
Harry Curtis.
And I assume you are?
I am Jack McCulkin, the project engineer.
Okay.
And these are the certificate of mailings.
Oh, thank you. Okay. Unfortunately, we do not have the whiteboard tonight, so we'll have to take a look at the plan.
The plan that you have is the same plan that was submitted. We've just added some colors to it. And what we've got is the wetland boundary is shown in green, the erosion controls are shown in brown, and that's the setback area as well. In yellow, we've got the 100-foot buffer zone. So in order to accomplish the construction of two houses out here, we're going to extend the roadway through. In the process of doing that, we are filling a small isolated wetland area that will be replicated over in this area. We've got two detention areas, one over here and one over this area. We're removing 85% total suspended solids, exceeding the 80% minimal requirement from DEP. We're infiltrating the surface runoff, the roof runoff, and that's about it. It's a pretty simple project. There's not a lot going on. The DEP has requested more information on our wetland replication, and we will, of course, be providing that for them and to you at the same time.
The comment from the DEP is they need a cross-section of the proposed replication area with estimated seasonal high groundwater elevations. And it says CMAS DEP replication guidance, which I don't kind of disagree with that. One of the things I did notice, and I'll start some of the comments, is that we spent a lot of time going over wetlands areas out in the field, and we had third-party review. There is a series of there's an isolated wetland that's over 500 square feet that is identified in D series, and
yes, I think that's the B, right, Jay?
No, it is the D.
There's a, like D1, D2, D3, D4, and then there's an A and a B. We added a piece after a lot of discussion, and that made it a little over 500 square feet. It is not it doesn't show on your existing conditions plan, and I was thinking that that might be a problem if, you know, you go to bid this to somebody to do the construction, and you know you're supposed to take one of the things you're doing with your replication area is using some of the soils in that area, and you know, using that in the replication. If they don't know where that D series is, it's not to say that your subdivision wouldn't happen quickly, but we've had some that have lingered for like 7 years, And now you know, you've lost you know, none of us would know because we'd be we would have changed.
Yeah. We could
and
add
so,
that to the plan easily.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that's really important.
Okay.
Another question I have is this Filtrec system. Is it Filtrec?
Filterra.
It looks really very innovative and interesting, and I did see an operations and maintenance plan. It looks pretty maintenance heavy. It seems like there's a lot of maintenance involved with this system. Have you used this in the past someplace?
I have. That was really one of the only BMPs I could find for that area. And it was recommended to me by some other contacts. And I researched a little bit. It's been around for about 15 years. It was tested by the New Jersey Center for Advanced Technology, which I think is the, I guess that's the current agency now that DEP looks to for proprietary filters. And I actually have the results if you want me to submit a copy.
Sure, that'd be great.
Actually, that's a little maintenance intensive during the construction phases. But the studies show that after everything is built and after all the lawns are in and so stabilized, a typical detention pond will require over 20 years before it needs any kind of maintenance at all. And it's the same with this kind of thing. Once the site is stabilized, it doesn't really receive that much and it doesn't require that much maintenance. It's only during the construction phases that it's likely to have maintenance issues.
The plan that I read, maybe I'm thinking about something else, in the back here said you had to remove the tree grate and erosion control, the stones, the debris, the mulch. And it was talking about doing that at some point, I think, in the maintenance plan. Once a year and other parts.
Well, it does need inspections, no question about it. But I inspect four different sites in Andover on a yearly basis. They all have a storm scepter in them. They've been in place for 10 years. And since they were put in place, they only have roughly 2 inches of sediment on the bottom, and we don't have to do anything to it until it has 2 feet.
Yeah.
So the accumulation of sediment after it's constructed is really minimal. During the construction phase, that's an entirely different story.
Right. Yeah, they recommend it doesn't go online until after everything's stabilized.
Okay. Who's going to maintain this system? Is this something that the DPW is going to, our Reading DPW is going to have to go in and maintain?
Yeah, we're working that out with them now.
Yeah, there may be some concern with that, so you're definitely going to have to, you know, Chuck Taroni and I talked about this afternoon, and that still is kind of up in the air. They don't know if they're going to be able to maintain that. And there may be some kind of a problem with the height of the road. I'm not sure. It's something to do with the detention basin. So, one other small item. You have one of your plans shows all of the mature trees greater than 6 dBH.
Yeah.
Okay. Did you also include any Norway spruce in that count of mature trees?
I did not.
And are there any out there?
There's a lot of them out there. The Norway maples.
Yeah, I'm sorry, Norway maples and black spruce.
Black spruce, I don't know. The only ones that I took out were the Norway maples.
I think we would like those. I mean, we have a pretty comprehensive tree policy now, and I think we would like to know where those are as well. Did you folks take a look at that? I actually kind of applaud you for that effort. That was pretty well done.
Thank you.
It does, it was well done, I agree. It did beg the question to me, post-development, you don't have any planting plans.
We actually have them right here.
Okay, so.
We had a landscape designer do a plan for tonight.
Okay.
A tree planting plan.
And it just wasn't prepared, it wasn't ready ahead of time?
No, just figured out the name, huh?
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, we'll review that and we'll discuss it. You know, we can't discuss it thoroughly tonight because we didn't receive it ahead of time to look at it.
That's right, I mean.
But we can discuss it. They can present it to us. We just need time to review it. We'll go over it a little bit more in detail the next meeting. I had a question about the slope of the road. It looks like the grade of the roadway in front of 36 Randall Road, map 10 parcel 1310, is 252, and the grade, you know, at the end of the cul-de-sac proposed is 262. So clearly the overland flow of the stormwater is going to be towards that existing 24-inch RCP drain, I assume, in the middle of the road.
I believe that's about a 6% grade.
Okay. But where's that sheet flow going? It's going towards that drain, right?
The circle gets collected by the two catch basins right at the base of the circle.
So will it be sort of graded away like it is on a highway?
Yeah,
you mean?
There'll be a crown right here, and each catch basin will catch its portion of the circle, and then the remaining pavement gets captured by the two fill terrace system, right at the bottom of the basically where the new pavement's going to start.
Okay.
So there won't be any more water sheeted down past number 39 Randall Road.
Can you go over that again, just a little bit more?
Yeah.
In detail.
The circle itself is going to get captured by two catch basins right at the base of the circle.
CB2 and CB1.
Yeah. And then those are going to discharge into the detention pond,
which is at lot one.
On lot one. And then that's going to discharge by a culvert underneath the road to a sediment forebay.
Okay.
On lot two, which will then go into a wet water quality swale, and then ultimately discharge into the existing wetland.
Discharge into the existing wetland by?
It's going to discharge right outside the swale and go by overland.
Oh, because I see a 250 contour around the the most down gradient swale.
The four veins.
Right. So what you're saying is it will go. Compass arrow here. It'll go west.
Yes.
It'll go, you're saying what doesn't get infiltrated into that forebay will go between the two 250 contours.
Exactly.
In that little vicinity. What is that rectangle at the end?
That's a little, like a check dam, a little berm.
Like a raised?
Yeah, it's probably like about, it might not even be a foot. I think it's about 9 inches.
And
just to keep the water in the wet swale and get the plant, that has to get planted with wetland plants as well.
Is there a schematic for that?
No.
Okay.
What's that consist of? The check dam?
the check dam, it's just basically a berm, like a grass berm.
It's a berm. It's going to be a berm.
Right.
And what's the square under the check dam?
Not sure.
That's touching the 250 number.
That's coming from the.
You know what I mean?
The
this.
Two
what's
fil-
this?
Filteros?
Oh yes.
If this is the check dam, what's
yes.
what's
that's
this?
The that, yeah, that's the riprap end of the. This these are the Filterra pipes.
Okay, so this these are Filterra. And this is a riprap spillway.
Yes.
Do I have those engineering terms right? I'm not an engineer.
Yeah, no, you're no.
Is there a reason that culvert doesn't go to the forebay instead of the outflow?
The Filterra?
Yeah.
Yeah, I just didn't have room to get my water quality volume. I just didn't have room in the swale.
Okay.
So is the small rectangle, sorry to be a detailed nitpicker here, but is this
that's
is this
a little check
also
dam.
Another check dam?
Yes, yeah.
Okay. So this is your sediment forebay?
Yep.
And can you tell me roughly where the water table is in this area?
In this area, in here, it's
about...
Sorry,
on lot two for the audience? Who
yeah, it's about elevation 248 to 49.
Okay. Okay. It's probably a lot lower today, but just because it's been dry. So basically, your calculations or your design do not contribute any road runoff to that existing 24-inch RCP drain.
Yes. I mean,
in front of 36 Randall Road.
So all your runoff goes into the replication area?
Yes.
Okay.
Has this been passed through town engineering for review?
It's under review.
It's under review at town engineering?
Right.
Okay.
So right. just continuing on that question, the road, does it slope west from the Filterra boxes? Or does it slope in both directions towards them?
No, it does slope west. It continues on west
okay.
To the culvert.
So everything west of the tree boxes does go into the existing Randall Road?
Yes.
Stormbank. Okay.
Yes, and that's where it goes now because that's really
is that the
where
extent
that circle
of the
is now.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Can I ask another question just regarding the house setup in lots 2 and 3? Is there a reason they were placed exactly on the 35-foot line? Or not given like a little bit of even buffer to allow for construction adjustments or, you know?
There's not a lot of room left there. I mean, we can have it pinned before we pour. So we can be sure that they'll be where they're designed to be, but there's not a lot of room to go somewhere else.
Okay. What happens sometimes is deck stairs
mm-hmm.
and deck additions start to encroach on that 35 foot. So sometimes, you know, to give the homeowner, you know, when the house and the house design is really maxed out, the homeowner sometimes is told, sometimes is not told that. Really, the way conditions are when they buy the house cannot be expanded on. Do you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, so if a design can kind of, you know, be economized to, well, there's two questions. One is, does the size and the orientation and the placement of the house and the deck, have to be exactly meeting our setback line, or is there a little bit of room in there, you know, for you know, some forgiveness during the construction and all that other process?
We'll look
you
at
know,
that.
If,
see if we can get some leeway in there.
And a second question is, if you don't mind, Rebecca, is the placement of the stairs around those decks and the placement of walkouts and
bulkheads
and outdoor heating, cooling, outdoor concrete pads, you know, the typical design stuff that comes up during house construction. It would be really, really good to have some of those at least identified around the house so that we know where, you know, typically erosion happens at the base of stairs, you know, so, you know, if people want to buy their house but put the stairs into the 35, you know, we sort of, it helps to know that now.
Where are you going to stage your materials?
On the unfinished roadway.
Okay. Do you have enough room?
What was that?
Do you have enough room? It's pretty tight back there.
Yeah, I think there's plenty of room to stockpile in the front.
So you would put the road in first?
We have to put the road in to access the thing, but you're only bringing up the binder, so you've got plenty of room to move stuff around.
The narrative to the NOI says there's going to be two homes. Two or three?
Three. Are there two homes within the buffer zone?
Yeah, the third one is outside the buffer zone.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Got it.
We didn't have a site visit because the layout has not been staked. We would like to see that.
Yes.
Okay. So Chuck conveyed that to you?
Yes.
Okay. All right. And I assume that the proposed 3-foot post and rail fence, that's the 25-foot natural vegetation zone?
Yes.
Okay.
The plan doesn't say that specifically, unless I missed it.
I think
it does.
Yeah, it does. 25-foot natural vegetation.
Oh, it does.
A2, okay, I see it.
Yep.
Yeah, I just saw it.
I couldn't find it. All right.
Yeah.
I think that's what it was. But.
I have a question. You know, I don't recall if when the delineation came before it previously, whether we had looked into this area, but I do recall not being a project there. Do we know where the wetland line continues as it gets goes across, you know, essentially the continuation of that road and towards like 11 Springvale Road.
Not sure I understand the question.
Just wants to know this, where it goes from here.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. It continues to run up in that direction.
Okay.
I'm not sure quite how far it goes. There's always a problem when you're flagging on somebody else's property. So. We try to refrain from doing that as much as possible.
Understand. I just wanted to make sure we take that into consideration, just from the standpoint of structures associated with Lot 1.
Yeah, in general, it's going away from where the construction is proposed.
Okay.
Doesn't this extend, does your property extend further to the east?
Not out.
I thought there was some kind of a Reading Open Land Trust back there. Right, okay.
Lots down from where they
okay. I'm wondering if you would consider some kind of a conservation restriction on this property in the wetland area.
I'm not sure what that would entail.
We need to look into it. Chuck and I talked about that this afternoon, and we would like to see if there's any benefit to property owners regarding.
If we can see the paperwork, then, you know, we'll consider it. Absolutely.
Yeah, we haven't put anything together or really looked into it. We do
the
have a couple
problem with
other.
The conservation restriction is getting it drawn up by an attorney,
mm-hmm.
putting it in place, getting it approved. It can be a real nightmare of a job. We've got a couple for natural heritage that we're working on right now, and it's taken months to get to where we are.
I'm just going to throw that out there. I have some few more notes if I can find them. So we have a landscape plan. Do we have any kind of a landscape plan for the replication area?
We do not.
We had a narrative on it, but we'll detail that more for DEP and for the commission.
Okay, right. Any other questions from members of the commission?
I had a couple quickies.
Okay.
The stormwater management plan calls for the Randall Road Homeowners Association to do maintenance. Is that definite or is that aspirational?
I think that's up in the air right now.
Okay. So, I mean, that's going to come back to the same question.
Right. The engineering has to review this.
All right. And then the operation maintenance plan for the deep sump catch basins, 4 times a year inspection, cleaned whenever the depth. I mean, are we really going to have people inspect it 4 times a year? Is that pretty routine?
Only during the construction stages, again. After it's construction, everything stabilized, it takes years and years before they receive enough. With a 4-foot sump, it can go up to 3 feet of sediment before it needs any kind of work at all.
So the reason I ask is same with the water quality swale, the four bay, inspected monthly, cleaned 4 times a year. That's what I was talking about. It wasn't the Filtrex. And when you write this in there and then you don't do it after the construction is complete, it's saying one thing and we're doing another. So I think it should be more clear about what we really think people should do. If we think it's inspect it once every 5 years, then say inspect it once every 5 years.
Yeah.
Right.
All right. We'll correct that.
You guys agree with that?
Yep. Yes.
Again, the studies show that, you know, even the four bay doesn't need maintenance for at least 20 years once it's stabilized.
Yeah.
It's once you get the vegetation and grass growing, it's remarkably stable.
Yeah.
I've been inspecting sites in Andover for 10 years. And
yeah, I'm not.
Every year I go in and I check them out. And I'm just,
that's
I'm
not my issue at all. My concern,
nothing in there.
My concern is just, you know, a year from now we say, did you do what you said you were going to do? Oh, we don't really need to do that. Well, it says you're supposed to do it. And then you end up fighting about something you don't want to fight about. That's all.
Right.
So do the two houses within the buffer zone, they have roof infiltration?
Yes. Yes, all three houses do.
That's what 2A, 2B, 3A, 3B are?
Yes.
Okay. And also the one across the street in lot one. Just curious, I don't think this is necessarily a wetland issue, so forgive me, but the lot line that crosses the paper road in between lot three and lot one, is that, how is that drawn? I mean, is that just the existing property line, or is that a...
No, I think you mean this one?
No, the one that Steve first pointed to.
Here?
Yeah.
No.
It between
comes down,
that crosses the paper road.
Oh,
it cuts right there.
This here, you mean?
Yeah.
That is that's actually the erosion control.
Oh, that's the erosion control.
Yeah, limit of work.
Oh, okay. Where
yeah.
is the property line then in that area?
Well, this property line ends here, and Randall Road, the paper road goes through like this.
Okay, so that continues to be. That continues to be a
paper road.
Right. Property of the town. That's
I don't think it's private.
Yeah, I was just wondering about that. Like, who owns that road?
Well, I think typically, if you abut a private road, that the owners own to the center of the road, each owner.
The way the lawyers explain it to me is they have rights to the center of the roadway. And if the town ever decides to take it or give up the rights to it, then they own it to the center of the road.
So it's a privately held road.
Yeah, but it's a legal issue that, you know.
Yeah,
none of us are attorneys.
I don't need to dabble in. I was just curious.
Just got to take my legal information with a grain of salt.
so.
I understand.
I have a question in regards to getting back a little bit to the drainage and just thinking of large storms coming through the road and high flows. So as it comes over the second weir you have here, I guess previously the way the impervious the pervious sections of the road area and anything that's going to the swales or the just to kind of run off either, I believe, down towards the
north to south.
Yeah, north to south. We're sort of directing it back up to a higher elevation and hoping that it just kind of takes this turn right at the end to get to the drainage well. I guess, what is this? You know, I can see you've got a couple contours here. I guess my concern is it actually going to end up where we want it to go, particularly in high flow conditions?
Well, yeah, I think this area down here now is probably going to be about 4 feet below the roadway. So I don't think there's any, if you're concerned, is it coming back uphill, even in a high flow situation. It's just not going to make it. And the flows are actually pretty small due to this detention pond holding it back. You know, I think they're, I have the figures, but I think they're around maybe three, I don't want to say, but they're pretty small, maybe around 3 or 4 CFS. So even in high flow situations, they're really
3 or 4 CFS.
And the slope from the cul-de-sac to the ditch, over that distance, it drops 10 feet.
This
from 260 roughly,
yes,
to about 252 and then even a little lower.
Right.
Which kind of goes back to, I was going to say this before, keep doing your thing.
Go ahead.
Okay. I feel like we're all over the place here sometimes. So house number two, lot three, the house on lot three, from front to back, it looks like it'll probably end up being a walkout basement.
Yes, yeah, both of those.
So I think it's really important that we, you know, something be done so that it doesn't become a de facto patio, to Becky's, or to Anika's point about the homeowners 6 months later decide to put in a patio and an air conditioner pad back there. Because if it's a walkout basement and it goes right to the grass, people's natural inclination is, I got a backyard here, let's put a patio in. So I don't know how you address that. I know you can't plan for what other people do down the road, but that's something we're going to want to just keep an eye on.
Can I ask just a question about the down gradient swales, just to stay within lot two, the FE1 and the FE2 area?
Yeah.
What's the thought process between making those two low zones separate from the wetland replication area instead of sort of in line with the flow towards the wetland replication area? Like, why have that 250 berm between the two?
It's an effort to meet the water quality volume standard. So you have to collect so much in the sediment pore bay, and then you have to collect so much in the water quality soil. And really, that's the only place I could fit it.
So it's to meet the engineering standards
the
of the stormwater management.
Stormwater management, right.
Okay. Because I guess one concern I'm thinking of is if in an extreme storm, and I need to double check the calculations and about the volumes of storm events, but there's so much happening in the western half of lot two. There's a lot of water management and a lot of there's a lot of water going there. There's a lot of changes that are going to happen because of the proposed replication, you know, which hopefully will uptake a lot of that water and provide an outlet for that. But you know, that's where a lot of treatment and management is happening, and that is, you know, that is right next to 36 Randall Road. So
right.
I'm going to look at that really carefully between now and the next meeting to see,
sure,
you know, how that balances and, you know, what it's, what the net outcome looks like, and I'm curious to hear what DPW and engineering's comments are, especially in that area.
I have some questions on your detention basin. Is that going to be dry most of the time, or do you have some kind of outlet that's up a little higher than the bottom of the
No, the outlet
is right at the bottom.
It's near the bottom.
Well,
let me just check.
According to what you said, the groundwater was, it was 248/249. So, FE2 is going to be wet.
No, I'm talking about this right
oh,
here.
Oh, that one. Okay.
So the bottom of the detention basin is 253.33, and the outlet is at 254.61, so it's about a foot, 4 inches maybe above, and that's for recharge.
Okay, all right. 253 down to 250. And the square at 249 across the street, that's going to be wet most of the time?
That is going to be, no, that's not going to be wet most of the time.
Okay.
That's up above the water table.
Okay.
And well, you said the water groundwater was 248, 249.
248 to 249, that's
right.
249 to 250. So that's just above the water table.
249. When you're talking about the four bay.
So it's just barely.
And then the next one will be 248, that will be wet.
And that's
wet.
The wet swale.
Okay, that's a wet swale. All right.
And you said there were going to be native plants in that?
Yeah, wetland plants, I think.
Yeah. We've got a list of them in the narrative.
Okay.
So when the project is done, that's all just, what's the overstory, understory kind of thought process, what that's going to look like? Does that look like a marsh? Does that look like a forest?
No, we pick out mostly facultative wetland species, because they're more likely to survive. They've got a 50-50 shot of growing in a wetland to begin with. So if you put facultative species in there, you're more likely to get a successful wetland replication area.
So but you're talking about plants that are generally going to top out at 3 feet, 6 feet, 30 feet?
Some of the biggest ones were shrubs.
Okay.
We didn't
okay.
call for any trees or anything.
Okay.
Well, biggest ones are shrubs, that'd be 5-6 feet if they got that high.
So the ones in the 248, that's the filtera structure? Would
no,
those?
That's just a swale.
The wet swale?
Yeah.
Would those be, you know, like a scirpus or something of that nature? You know, wetland grasses, rushes?
For the swale?
Yeah.
They'll probably be that, but we'd start out with regular grass.
Regular grass.
To stabilize it quickly. It's not going to be running water all the time, so.
Okay. In the detention basin across, that would be grassed?
Grassed.
Yep, okay. All right.
I would, so you said you had a list of plantings within the western part of Lot 2. You said you had a list in the narrative?
Yes.
Is it possible, and I don't need something as fancy or nice or produced as this, but I would like to see around those basins, if it isn't clear yet, I'd like to see a planting plan for the replication area and the area between that replication and the street. Because there's a bit here, but I'm not sure where on this plan, you know, the detention basins, are they over here, are they here, you know, so, do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't have any other questions at this point. Maybe open it to the public or...
Yeah. Would there... In the area of the isolated wetland, were there a lot of invasives? I can't remember that there were.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the D1.
Not a lot. There were
a few, but there weren't a lot. It wasn't like it was covered with loose stripe because it was in a shaded area.
Right.
If it's in a shaded area, you don't generally get the invasives. It's in the open sun when you get the invasives.
Which is good because you're proposing to use some of the soil as part of the replication. Is that, am I correct reading that?
Yes.
Huh.
I think we're going to have to add to it and augment it because
definitely.
It's not great soil.
Right. You're doing a 2-to-1 replacement, right?
Yes.
Right. You definitely have to augment it. Mm-hmm. You don't have enough volume in that area. And I don't even know how deep those soils would go. Any other questions from members of the commission?
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to open it up to members of the audience and neighborhood. Yes, your name?
I'm Adina Wiseman, 29 Springvale Road. I have a couple of questions. One, the first may not be your issue. Do we not require for sidewalks to be around the cul-de-sac to continue the sidewalk? Or is that planning or somebody else?
Sidewalks?
Yes, there's a sidewalk on Randall Road, but there's no sidewalk around the cul-de-sac.
I see it on the plan.
Is it?
That is correct. I mean, you're correct. That's the way it's. It's actually the sidewalks are going to continue on right up to the cul-de-sac.
But not around.
Right,
the
because the cul-de-sac is right. Actually the pavement is actually going to be the property line. So anything on the outside of the cul-de-sac will be private property.
So there are no sidewalks.
No sidewalks around the cul-de-sac.
But sidewalks along up to the cul-de-sac, up to the round piece.
Right.
But you're correct. We don't have jurisdiction over whether sidewalks go in or not.
Okay. And two other questions. Yesterday at the meeting, you talked on the plans that we saw, there were decks on all three houses.
Yes.
But there are not decks on these plans, and one of the trees is like right where I think you said the decks were going. So my question is on these plans here, I believe you showed gaps coming up here and up here.
Yeah, currently on
the
side.
Oh, yeah.
Currently
trees,
on lot one.
There are
lot
trees
this one.
So just want to call that out.
Yeah. Ooh.
The landscaper architect didn't have all the information. This plan would supersede that plan.
Got it. Okay.
Just to give you an idea of how many trees are going to be replanted.
Yep. Okay, so that was my question. And then the last question is just, you know, so somebody doesn't plant it where something's going, is when I count up the trees on this plan, there are 19, and at yesterday's meeting, you indicated that 19 trees are being removed. Is this part of the replacement, or is this separate from the replacement of the good trees?
I think that is the replacement.
So street,
that's the idea.
So street trees are not required, you're considering that part of the replacement plan? I'm just trying to catch it in my head.
I actually haven't seen that plan, Mark just got it today. So how many trees are on that plan?
19.
There's 19, and are there street trees on it?
Yes.
Okay, so that was my thought process, that the street trees do count towards the replacement.
So what's on here is the replacement plan of the 19 trees that you referenced yesterday. Am I saying that correctly?
Yeah.
Okay.
Can I just see it?
Oh,
before I say
yes. Sure.
I noticed more than
you. Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
19.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Just
want
to be sure I understood. Because you indicated earlier
stuff. Okay. Wait.
Cedar.
You know what I'm confused about is
that hasn't been shown, but this is
all those trees.
Existing trees.
This plan would supersede that plan. That's just a general idea.
Just count it up.
So I should explain that.
Okay.
But I think eventually
and
that plan.
The species of your trees are on there.
No,
either.
And I
you know, fence
yes,
isn't on there.
That's
either.
A
good
thing.
But the
should we be friends? I'm sorry, can we, when you speak, just say who's talking and your address?
So,
I'm sorry.
I'm just trying to clarify, you know, the plans here, and also just because it's not showing, the trees we talked about yesterday behind my property are not showing here, so how do I know that will occur if they're not on the plan?
I think because your property's actually outside their jurisdiction, I think that'll come up during the planning.
That makes sense.
November 7th.
Okay, thank you.
I have a question for you guys. The 19 trees that you were talking about?
Yeah, you haven't got that yet, but what...
Okay.
Well, what's happened is, at the DRT meeting, when we met with Chuck and everybody else, Chuck explained that all he really needs are the trees within the buffer zone, and that the invasive trees, you typically discount. He didn't say you would necessarily, but he said you typically do that. So I have another preliminary plan that I've done that shows the invasives and the non-invasives, and there's 19 non-invasives, so that's how we came up with the number 19. So we've been working on that even today.
Okay. So you're talking about the mature trees back in here, in our 100-foot buffer zone. Okay. However, did you also include the ones that you have to cut down? It looks like you have maybe two in the detention, not the detention, but the isolated wetland area?
Yes, yeah, we included all.
Okay. So everything within this yellow towards the wetland, you've included all the mature trees, and you've counted 19 of them?
19 non-invasives.
And what do you have for...
invasives?
Yeah.
Actually, I think it's about the same. It might be in here.
38.
Preliminary.
This one, too, is
thank you.
Yeah. Want to update one, or do you want to look at it?
No, I just kind of want to know, and we would be including the invasives as well, the mature. Any other questions from...
My name is Chris Sandgren. I'm from 39 Randall Road.
Yep.
And the detention base is very close to our house. And we have already two sump pumps working on that, on the boiler room and on the basement. Is the basin going to give us any problem on the water problem in the future? That's going to collect all the waters that...
Right, and the way that's designed is it's going to either recharge the water back in the ground, or it's going to discharge across the street to the replicated wetland. And in your case, because right now this water goes from south to north, basically into this low point, and actually travels across your property for a little bit. So we're actually putting in a little berm, almost right along the property line, a little 2-foot berm, so that any water that's coming there now is actually going to get directed either into the pond or at least into the street. So you'll actually be getting a little bit less water than you do now.
That's surface flow.
That's
less
surface flow.
Recharge, I mean, there's no way that the water that's recharging here, I mean, this is probably 30, 40 feet away from the property line, probably 50, 60 feet away from its basement, and it only recharges in this small area.
Not a lot of recharge.
Yeah.
Just for information, what does the basin looks like? Is it going to be?
It's pretty flat, actually. It's a 4-to-1 slope, which is a pretty gentle slope. And that's actually the town requirement. It's going to be, flat enough to mow. And it's going to be grass.
So what are the, just to give us a picture, is it like the size of this room? Is it,
30 by 40, is it?
It's
8 by 10?
You know, at the base, it's probably about 7 by 20. And then at the top, oh, probably maybe 20 by 40.
20 by 40.
One more question on the.
There is more
than 40 years old fence there, because I've been living there for more than 39 years. Is that going to be there? Because all the time that's been falling in our yard, and I had to put it back one section.
This fence right here?
That's not our fence anyway.
Right. Is that fence on this property, our property?
It's really safe for sure.
It is?
Yes.
It is. Mm-hmm. So it'll be replaced. If it's in disrepair, then it will be replaced. That's not a conservation issue, but I didn't tell you that I would do that.
Okay. Yeah, that's not there in the
Either a tree fence, you know, a natural fence or a wooden fence, one or the other.
Yeah, okay. So it could be replaced, because nothing is mentioned on the drawing here right now, because on the backside of the house, I can see the decorative fence and some pine fence and other things, but nothing on the side here, so I just thought, okay, I want to make sure about it.
Like number 29, we met months ago when she requested trees, and they got on the plan because it was months ago, but we just talked about this last night.
So. Okay, that's great.
So Mr. Sankaran, there's a fence there now? Right here?
Yeah.
There's a fence, and it's falling in?
Yeah.
And it's wooden? What kind of a fence is it again?
It's a wooden fence.
Stockade fence?
It's
a 6-foot stockade.
Okay. So you guys are going to take it down?
Yeah, I think
it's outside the buffer zone, but I've got to. We just discovered this question last night, so
yeah.
I haven't had a chance to put it on the plan yet, but I will.
Well, actually, no. It is in part of the buffer zone at the 254, the 100-foot buffer. So. Questions? Other questions?
I have a question. Peter Shields, 31 Randall. Talking about this berm by the detention pond, I've heard 1 to 2 feet, I've heard 6 inches, and I've heard mowable. When I try to mow my berm now from the street to the grass, it scalps it. So that's probably a rise of 4 inches or something like that. How is that going to be maintained?
You're asking about the detention pond?
The one near the detention pond.
Yeah.
The berm?
Yeah.
That berm, it's about 2 feet wide and 1 foot high. And that little berm will probably get planted, I think, with something other than grass. It's going to be right along the property line, I would assume.
Okay.
But that's the only, and there's one on the other side as well. But everything else is mowable.
You heard my description of mowable, right? Something like that, or more like that.
Yeah.
I don't think a weed whacker.
Are you saying that would be up to the property owner, because there's nothing on the landscape plan that shows any.
A planting, you mean, on the that berm?
Yeah.
I'm just assuming that's probably what's going to happen eventually.
So, I'm sorry, is the detention pond on the land of the house?
Yes.
So that's not public land, that's part of their property?
That's correct.
Yeah.
That's correct.
They can own it?
What is that?
So the homeowner has to know?
Yes. Or I guess they don't have to know.
I think that depends on the DPW arrangement, doesn't it? You are in negotiations with DPW about maintaining that.
Right.
But typically, most homeowners in town don't wait for DPW to show up. Typically, they just take matters into their own hands.
They would, if it's grass, they would mow it. There are several in town, in other subdivisions. Bethune. That's actually a really big one, and that is mowed by the property owner.
I've been hearing wetland plants for the detention area.
No, not for the detention basin on the other side of the road. The wetland plants in the replication area, as well as the last long...
The wet swale,
you're right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And those wouldn't... You wouldn't be planting shrubs. That would be more of like a grass. That would colonize with wetland, you know, low-growing vegetation, not...
You know, just as a point, a low-lying area like that, right next to a road, that wet swale, I have a couple concerns that that it might become an accumulation of yard debris or street side trash.
I think that seems unlikely in this kind of a neighborhood.
Well, I would also jump to that conclusion, but I've seen examples around town. Well, I know, but strategic plantings can restrict easy access to some of those areas as well.
There's no protection from people who are really slobs.
You can post signs. You can, I mean, there's a lot that can be done. We can issue tickets. We can issue enforcement orders for illegal filling of wetlands. I mean, there's a lot we can do.
I want to make something clear. This is a stormwater system. It doesn't become a wetland. Is that not correct?
Yes.
It will function as a wetland.
Right.
It's going to be maintained.
But it's not. I just want to make that clear.
I understand. I'm just thinking, you know, based on what I've seen in across the town, I'm not pointing fingers at anybody in specifically, but across town we have had low-lying areas next to roads filled in by landscapers, filled in by... you know, by people who just say, hey, look, some low area that we can use as a temporary dump, you know. So I think the more protected that area is, especially along the road, I think the more it will serve its intended purpose.
Any other questions from the community?
Formulating it.
That's a long sigh.
Yeah, short mind. I'm concerned, and this was, you weren't attending the meeting last night, but it was brought up at the meeting, that we're looking at repeating history, if you would. When Randall Road was built, where it ended was supposedly, I don't know who said it was a wetland.
It was never a wetland. She's the one that lives on it.
Yeah, that's right. You mentioned that last night.
Yes.
Was the reason he stopped building.
That's
what
we
were told.
That's what it was owned by somebody else. He stopped building because it was owned by somebody, and they would not allow them to build past where they built.
Why are they
it sure is now.
Because he doesn't own the property anymore. The gentleman that owned it.
His daughter owns it.
He
left it to her. He didn't sell it. He left it to his daughter.
His daughter's letting him.
And she sold... never mind. I can't get into this. It was never a wetland.
Okay.
Positively, it was never a wetland.
But there are wetlands back there, right, behind Springville? Like behind 10 Springville and or 11?
Well, yes, we have a wetlands line that we confirmed last year.
And it's going to get added to the plan.
But where they're going around the wetlands?
They're designed right now, so the reason they have a replication area, that very, very shaded trapezoid right there that he's pointing to, is to replace wetlands that the road is filling. A small, isolated wetlands. That's, when I say small, we're talking 500 square feet.
And it's what, within our Reading bylaw, but not under the Wetlands Protection Act for Massachusetts.
That
is too small.
That road that goes past the cul-de-sac doesn't go anywhere, right? So their traffic is going to come down West Cross for Springvale to get to those houses.
Road showing?
Like, would you call it a something road?
Yeah,
paper
road.
Paper road.
What is that? Just
it's just on paper only.
There's a lot of wetland back there. It would be hard pressed to continue anything back there. So that wetland gets pretty wet. Going further back. Yeah, it's shown as a green line on that plan.
Which is why I'm standing now. I'm saying we're looking at history repeating itself. When these places were built, all due respect to the lady over here, it's all hearsay, and does anybody have records from the 70s so we can see if it was actually delineated someplace?
Can I say something?
Sure.
We delineated this last year, and
yes.
Things do change as
yeah.
things progress, things get built, things dry out, you know, changes. And it was pretty controversial. And we did a step beyond and hired a third-party consultant to look at this area and give us the best indication of a wetland.
Okay.
And we have concurred with that wetland line. So we're not going back to history, and we're not going back to see where any other old wetland lines were.
The wetland line isn't in question. It was approved in the NRAD.
Correct.
Once again?
The wetland line that is currently shown is not in question.
This is cool. What I'm saying is the wetland line, if it was a line when they stopped their building and all the rest, is no longer wetland. Because we're up two or three housing lots now.
There could be a couple of reasons for that. One is, I believe the Wetland Protection Act was in 1972. Prior to that, it was legal to fill the wetlands. The other thing is that in somewhere around 95, the definition of a wetland changed with DEP. It went from strictly vegetation to including soils, a more science-based method. So the regulations changed. Nobody can control that on our side. We just make sure our client complies with them.
Perhaps I'm a little bit slow getting to the point. I want to establish the fact that what we're looking at now is normally not wetland. Although, if you went to Mr. Coleman's yard and did a soil sample, you'd probably call him wetland too, right now. Because I towed one of his cars out of his lawn a bit ago because it's sunk into the mud. That is wet down a little bit, and I also just throw this out. You're right. Wetland is retained water in the soil and vegetation. Like that?
The definition of a wetland based on hybrid soil is water at or near the surface for a significant portion of the year, where at or near the surface is 12 inches, and a significant portion of the year is only 10 days during the growing season. So if we have a water table within 12 inches, we consider that a wetland. If it's 11 inches, it's a wetland. If it's 13 inches, it's not a wetland.
Not a wetland, okay.
If we could determine the water table that accurately, it would be great, but we can't.
Okay. The other half was the vegetation. This was delineated before the vegetation was growing. So you threw away half of your evidence. Now, I know you said that it's now accepted. Now, like I said, I rose for another reason.
What?
It came, the wetlands used to be over here. We built the homes, and now we're saying, look, the wetlands retreated. And that's not unusual. As it turns out, there's some statutes, is that a good word, Frank? That say, or they have required, maintaining the existing canopy, because if you don't, it'll dry out more wetland. And if we're looking at wetlands as a resource, we're going to kill them. That's simple. So they're saying in this other particular case, and saw it somewhere, not sure what the source was, but they were stopped in their tracks on account of this decision, this court decision. And I'm saying, okay, it came back to here. We do this, and it's going to come back to here. And we have lost our resource.
You haven't lost the resource. You still have. We do maintain a zone of natural vegetation. And we don't know what this particular case that you're talking about, we don't have any idea what the
Can't
parameters were.
Yeah,
it's
word
I, you
of
know,
mouth to you, it's word of mouth to me.
Okay.
And we're trying to recoup it now. Now, if we don't have it recouped, we need to ignore it.
I can tell you from the soil test that even though the soil in this area is disturbed, this was not a wetland in the past. And I can tell that from the soil. It doesn't change. Once it gets the redoxymorphic features that make it a wetland, it doesn't change again. I mean, you could drain the entire water table out, those features would still be there.
That's true. Yeah. That's true.
Mr. Shields, another way to look at it is we actually put these guys through the ringer a little bit as it related to applying the Reading Town bylaw to about a 600 square foot section of wetland. And the replication requirement in our bylaw is to replace that 2-for-1. So there's actually going to be twice as much wetland replaced as removed. And it's being placed adjacent to the existing wetland. So you're going to have a larger contiguous wetland than you had before. So it's actually, from that standpoint, a really good plan, because it consolidates the wetland in a place where it can be better monitored and better maintained than what you have there today. So, and for everybody that wants a really wet area with a lot of trees, there's somebody else that doesn't want any more water in his basement. So, you know, that's something that's gonna take place over the next few decades. People are gonna, you know, sort of work their own properties to make sure that their basements don't flood, but that their wetland doesn't dry out. And that's where the community kind of takes over, and where our responsibility stops is we set the line, we approve a reasonable plan that achieves the requirements of the regulations, which is what we're trying to do tonight.
Okay, we have to move on. And I appreciate all your comments. I think we've exhausted most of the comments, and do I hear a motion to continue?
Yeah, so it sounds like, just to recap, sounds like we would like to do a site visit prior to the
right.
next meeting. There are some things we had discussed, but you know, make sure we can get some locations marked out, and if we could try to schedule a site visit.
When do you do your site visit?
Either Sunday morning, night starting at 9 o'clock, or Tuesday afternoons.
Do
going to start losing Tuesday afternoons pretty quickly.
Well, you are.
Well, I think our schedule has maybe one or maybe two more meetings this year. Is that correct?
We have one the 9th of November. And
I don't think we have a December one, but I'll double check.
We have one in December.
Okay. Do we have two in November?
I think we only have one in November.
Okay.
December is just the 14th.
Okay.
All right. So this is continued on, as it's been set?
We haven't made a motion yet.
So
do you want to make this part of the regular site visits? Is it something that we are going to need a little extra time for and schedule? I don't know. We all know this.
I suspect it would take a Sunday morning
for
this one. Because we start at 9, so it gives us, you know, at least a couple hours.
Yeah.
But I don't even think there will need a couple hours.
We all know the site pretty well.
All right.
I make a motion to continue. NOI 470-0673.
Okay. All those in favor? Okay. So it will be continued. Hopefully to the November 9th, if they can stake the layout of the subdivision in the field.
Otherwise, it's December 14th.
Otherwise, December 14th.
It'll be safe.
Okay, thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for the presentation.
Okay, moving right along.
Oh, you had to do that, didn't you?
Yeah, I did.
Okay, we have a continuation of 147 Pearl Street. And we got some plans this afternoon. So I have to go through the notice of intent again. This is a public hearing for ...147 Pearl, notice of intent 270-0672. And is now reopened, and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Mass Wetlands Protection Act, Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended, and the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. Applicant will present the proposal. Commission receives reports. A commission will address questions, comments to the applicant, and the public will give me the opportunity to ask questions. At this time, I'd like to introduce members of the commission starting on my right.
Harry Curtis.
Rebecca Longley, Chair.
Anika Scanlon, Vice Chair.
Michael Flynn.
Okay. So we got these plans today.
Mm-hmm. So the change in plan shows two dogwoods added along the southeastern fence and two rows of stone infiltrator trenches, one along the southern side of the driveway and one along the northern, northeastern side of the proposed garage.
Right. What I noticed is also the 35-foot zone of natural vegetation has been relabeled. And they provided a stone trench cross-section detail. We had asked for calculations, but they didn't think that had been necessary. Calculations for the stone trench cross-section.
Infiltration?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
But, you know, we've looked at other sites, and there's another engineer that has infiltrated similar structure with actually a smaller structure.
Mm.
Shackford Road.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So.
Smaller than 2x2?
Yeah, it was 1.5 wide by 1.5 deep.
So just remind me though, I apologize. We looked at this last time, and I wasn't on the site visit when we originally did this. So there's a driveway currently that goes to the left side and the northeast side of the site. And I think that garage or whatever it is was going to be turned into a living room or another sort of living space.
It's never a garage. It's an elevated addition.
Oh, okay.
You couldn't even get a car under there.
Okay.
It's not really a carport.
All right. And then there's currently a driveway that's kind of a horseshoe shape.
Circle.
Going around. Okay.
Yeah.
And both of those are going to remain. And then.
Well, we were willing to get rid of the horseshoe driveway.
Okay.
If we could keep the one on the left because we store things under there. It's more usable to us.
Yeah.
If we kept that one and we could. Needed to, we could get rid of.
Yeah, I think we had talked about that last week.
Yes, and so so the horseshoe, because I think the last week when I was looking at the driveways, I didn't even realize there was the horseshoe there.
Yeah.
So the horseshoe would essentially be taken out, and then the increase, because it's not just the building that we're talking about for infiltration, but that now water would be coming down
the new driveway.
Yeah.
And go into that infiltration.
But so that would just be part of it. And and so in essence, we're decreasing the area. Well, I don't know. Was there ever a calculation for what the net increase was? You know, if we take out the driveway, but at the new driveway?
We'd have to get a civil engineer for that.
Greater expense.
Not necessarily a calculation for the capacity of these trenches, but just what can be figured out is the approximate area of the horseshoe. So.
Comparison.
Yeah, exactly.
What we're trying to do is measure the total additions to impervious surface that you're adding: so the garage, the pool and its patio, and the driveway. Right. So say that adds up to 1,000 square feet. We want to see
minus the driveway that's being taken away.
We want to see how much of that is being remediated by the trench, by the driveway being removed, because we want to keep that neutral.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, we can't really tell without any kind of area calculations on here.
And again, that was just that's a civil engineer, and that's 1,000. I mean, we're talking, by the time they get the garage, I mean, you're talking a $90,000 garage by the time you do all these calculations you're looking for. It doesn't make, I mean, they're basically, if that expense is on them, then they're probably going to wind up selling and moving. You know, I mean, it gets to a.
It's something I could do with a protractor and a compass in an hour, probably. So we're not talking about putting you guys through a lot of hoops. We've got a responsibility to make sure that what we're approving is in compliance with the Wetlands Protection Act. And
okay.
It doesn't have to be down to the penny, but we're going to be pretty close to understand that, because every time you do one of these, if you wing it and you get more and more water running off, you know, you end up with water in the streets. And that's what we're trying to avoid.
So So how do we?
I understand. This whole property, all pitches towards this. I'm going to call it a drainage ditch.
Yeah, that's
the whole
what it
property
is.
Leans that way.
Right.
I mean.
And so the rationale for why we're asking for this,
yeah,
is when, if you imagine if you paved the whole lot, the,
yeah,
water will run right into the ditch, right down the tube, and into Timberneck, right?
Right.
And if everybody did that, all the water races into Timberneck, and you end up flooding a road downstream. So that's the reason you have pervious soil upstream, so the water can soak into the ground instead of running into the trench.
I don't know. I kind of disagree with you, Harry. I mean,
we're not saying we have to, maybe we can figure that out here, but that's what we asked for.
I know that's what we asked for, but I feel comfortable with their removing the circular driveway. They're putting in a new driveway, but they didn't have infiltration. They didn't have anything to infiltrate previously, and you were talking about a lot of impervious surface, and now considerable more of impervious surface is being put into that filtration area. And what I'm saying is that we've had other engineers in town using some, you know, it's kind of probably kind of the same kind of soils, and they're actually using smaller systems.
No,
would you guys like to know some rough numbers I estimated?
Yeah, that's,
just
I think
right
that's
now.
Okay, what's your rough number?
Rough numbers. I'm just estimating. The curve arc removed of the driveway is about 400 square feet, plus or minus. and I have a proposed the pool plus patio. I have roughly 730 square feet. If you include the proposed concrete apron.
But that's not going to the
impervious.
No. That's
But what I'm saying is, if you're talking about, you know, so the garage is what, 360? 360 according to the plan. So
360 square feet?
The garage.
Okay, and what's the driveway going down?
Well, 360, that's 24. Wait, the garage says it's 24 square. Sorry.
What's this?
Sorry, I didn't do that driveway, but I don't know. I can figure that out while you continue to talk if you want. I don't know. Let's
say
40
square
inches.
Feet on the curved driveway, or 400?
400.
Okay.
I mean, I don't know how accurate I am on that, but. So let's see, 24 times 24, that's. So. If the garage is truly finished 24 square, that proposed garage is 576.
Where did you get 360?
Yeah, area of proposed garage inside the rear yard, 360 SF on the side of the plan over here. So here, the numbers I'm using to sort of approximate are a rough ratio of the scale shown on the plan.
So the driveway is about 12 feet wide, ish.
Okay, so 12, and what do you think the run is? Let's see, that's, according to my ruler, it's approximately 2 inches, which would put it at... 40 plus 60, yeah.
Maybe 500 square feet, the driveway, because it curves out in front of the garage.
Yeah.
So you got 500 with the driveway.
And 576.
And what's 576?
Is the garage, proposed garage.
107.
And then we're adding a pool.
And the pool and patio I roughly did is 730.
So could you clarify again, because I think we talked about this last time, is the 5 foot, that I think that's the only section that's concrete?
So that's
is the this corner here, is that the patio that comes around?
1806 minus 400
what's,
is total.
What's this going to be?
That would
total
be pavers.
That is
additional
pavers.
Impervious
pavers, yeah.
Is 1406. Well, 1400, let's just say. 1400 square feet.
additional impervious.
So 1,400 is what we're adding?
The net, when you take out the driveway, that's 1,400 square feet additional impervious from the pool, the patio, the garage, and the additional driveway.
So 1,400 net, but they're infiltrating off the garage and really most of the driveway.
Because it slopes, because it's gray, it slopes towards the...
And that's about 1,000. So you're talking about net out of about 400.
No.
I already factored in the 400 of the arc to be removed.
That was 1,400 square feet, but you're putting in 1,076 impervious surface into the new infiltration where there was none before.
Right.
Leaving 400.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So 400 is being added impervious.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we're trying to get to, because
we
need to make sure that.
When you guys are talking drainage counts, civil engineer, I don't even begin to know where to go with that. And I guess the surveyor talked to Chuck.
And Chuck felt like that they came to an agreement that this was a pretty good
agreement.
Compromise?
Yeah.
So is the restriction, there's a maximum lot coverage of 25%? Is that true? That's what you have on your plan?
That's maximum lot coverage is, that's...
According to zoning?
According to zoning, yeah, and we're at proposed
22.6%.
So,
22.6. So I think that they did, that you've had discussions with...
With Glenn?
Yeah.
And I've also been to engineering as well on the new proposed driveway.
Okay.
As far as curb cuts and everything, engineering's okay with it and Glenn was okay with it.
And we had asked for two replacement native trees, and as you can see, they've got the proposed dogwood trees. And there was a neighbor here last week, and I think you folks talked to him. And
we did.
And he's okay with the placement of those trees, I think. Any other questions from the commission?
No.
Are we in agreement that we don't need any further calculations?
Yep.
Okay. I'd like to open this up to this gentleman.
Good. Hello. I'm here for something else.
Oh, okay. I got it.
Unless you want me to challenge,
I don't think they do. anybody have an opportunity to look over the order of conditions?
I did. It looked good.
Yep, it looked good. There are just a couple of small typos.
Okay,
I do. Small typos, and I just wanted to make sure that the new updated plan was put in to the findings, the documents.
Okay. I have the order of conditions, and we can sign those tonight with the changes. And Anika, if I could take your copy and take those.
Take a vote first.
Yes. Well, I just want to kind of get this cleared.
Yeah.
All right.
Well, yeah. That there's no other changes.
Right. Do I have a motion to close the notice of intent?
I make a motion to close notice of intent for NOI 270-0672, 147 Pearl Street.
I'll second.
All those in favor?
Make a motion to approve the order of conditions as amended. Just some minor
typos.
Yep.
Tense changes.
Yep.
I'll second.
Those in favor? Okay. There is a 10-day appeal period.
Sure.
I'll start. Did Chuck talk to you about that?
Yep.
The appeal period? Okay.
Yep. How do we find out if somebody filed for an appeal?
Have you had any bad discussions with neighbors?
No.
All right, well, chances are, I mean, you can't take it to the bank. Chances are there's not going to be an appeal.
You might get a notice.
But I can't officially tell you to go ahead with the appeal period.
You'd get, if Chuck knew about it, he would tell you.
You'll know.
And then, you know, if it went to DEP, they'd give you notification as well.
Anika's going to send you a bill for her engineering services.
Yeah, those 2 minutes of calculators.
Thank you very much.
Anytime. It's all that math class stuff, you know. They say it doesn't come in handy, but.
I tell my daughter math is the most important tool.
You know, for me, the most important class I ever took was field geology. The teacher actually had us go out and walk our pace a million times so that, and then he made us write it down so that when we're in the field, we knew what our typical standard walk was. And we could use that as a measuring stick to put on a map to say, so you could decide when you were 100 feet from something or 60 feet. That was useful. That's come in handy. And also getting to know how to use a scale ruler, that helps too. All right, so anyway, there it is. Go take a field geology class. You'll love it. I don't think you have to be pursuing a degree for that. But.
Okay, great. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
You too. Next on the agenda is...
Wall Street.
Yeah. The enforcement order, and they've done everything. They've removed the retaining wall, rebuilt the new retaining wall, regraded under the existing enforcement order, and the rest of the work is covered under the order conditions. But I don't know if the order conditions got recorded. Recorded. Does it matter?
Does for anything that wasn't in the enforcement order.
It might matter.
All right, then we can't vote to rescind. It will only be a rescinding.
Why wouldn't it have gotten recorded?
They haven't come back from Nepal.
I think they have to put... They would have to prove. They have to... Don't they get a receipt when they record the order?
Yeah.
Yeah, so they would have to hand that over to Chuck.
Yeah.
And he would say, yeah, the it was recorded.
We're not holding them up on anything.
No.
I don't think there's any damage.
No. Okay. We'll have to continue that or we'll talk about that the next meeting. And I think this is the enforcement order for 582 Summer Avenue. Mr. Murata?
Yes. Jason Murata, 526 Summer Avenue.
Oh, 526.
And yeah, it's Jason, not James. Murata with an O, M-A-R-O-T-T-A.
Murata?
Murata. M-A-R-O-T-T-A.
Okay. Murata.
Yeah, good. We got it.
What was the number again? I'm sorry.
526.
526, thank you. You got the enforcement order, right?
I did, yeah. Apparently, they only try certified mail once a week in my street. I don't know why that is, but I didn't get it till Monday evening. No, Tuesday, yesterday. And I talked to Chuck, and he said he'd come down today.
Okay. And this was a case of cut trees. I guess there were three of them that were cut beyond our jurisdiction, which is 100 feet from wetland resource area.
From what I understand, yeah.
Right. And then there were two that were cut within, I don't know, 80 feet to the wetland area. One was a white pine, and...
One was a white pine. The other was, I don't know, because it was so dead. I don't know what it was. But it was starting to drop boughs and branches into the yard. But there are other trees that are surrounded that weren't touched.
Right. You don't have any photos of those trees, do you?
I don't.
Okay.
No.
So we don't know if they were dead or not.
The condition.
Yeah, we don't know the condition of those trees.
There are, in the stand, there are other trees that are in the same condition. I don't know if that matters. but those are dropping, you know, major logs. The reason why I took them, one of the trees, and there were three trees in the back in the backyard that needed to be taken. The major oak in the middle, the previous owner, I've only been to the property the last 5.5 years or so. Previous owner put a dog line in the major trunk, and subsequently it's been sawing through that trunk.
Yeah.
So I obviously needed to go because it was, I have four kids on one side of me and five kids on the other side. That tree going either way would have caught one, at least one or two kids for sure. One of the neighbors has a pool, it would have landed in his pool. So that was the reason why it was done. The pine, the white pine, since I've been there, it was standing straight up when I moved in. It is now 20 degrees off vertical and was coming towards the house. So that's the reason why that white pine was taken. And there's other white pines in that cluster that I wasn't interested in taking because I like the trees. To be honest, I like all the trees. I just didn't think it was very safe to leave them up. And notwithstanding, I didn't know that they were in the buffer zone. So.
Right.
Because they were on the property, yes.
So your neighbor David Costello was your tree person?
Yeah, so I got his name from my neighbor across the street, Jake, and he's like, oh yeah, he's a tree guy. So he came up and took a look, and
yep.
I was like, that one? And he's like, yeah, that one obviously is completely dead. The pine, I guess there was some, he was like, there's something going on up top that I have to take a look at, and he's like, but it's so, I'm not willing to go up there without being on a crane because it was coming over. He didn't feel comfortable coming over,
okay.
You know, going up the tree.
Yeah.
And then the saw through was obviously, he's like, I have to take that, otherwise it's going to come fall one way or another.
So we do have a tree replacement policy that we have just put into place.
Okay.
After many months of discussion, and we typically don't require any replacement for damaged or diseased trees in our jurisdiction, but something that is healthy, and we don't really know. I'm going to take David Costello's word that one of your trees was really compromised, but we don't know about the pine. It may have been leaning, but it may have been healthy. So I'm assuming, I don't know.
Yeah, so I guess the question is, If I done the right thing, if I come to you guys, you come and take a look at it, say no, even though it was coming off center, off on vertical, and
no,
then something happened.
No, we wouldn't say no.
Okay.
This is the point. I guess I need to explain it a little bit more.
So if you had come before us, and it, because I can't remember what the 80, you know, when it's 80 out, it would have qualified as a minor project permit?
I think so, and so...
And
you know, a minor project is $50 and you have to notify abutters. So you're out $50. And then if you have a healthy tree, we would require a one-to-one replacement. Not a big, huge tree, but something, you know, like I think it's 3-inch diameter. Or you can also donate to our tree replacement fund. If you don't feel that... you have room on your property or it's not a good replacement, you know, then you can, you know, donate to the fund.
Sure. There's actually some options beyond just the one-to-one, the 3-inch. There's the, you know, we have some
criteria.
You could
yeah,
put
three
in shrubs too.
We have
okay.
There's a table that's available on the policy that actually outlines, you know, what would we replace. So if it had come before us, we would likely have, you know, have that healthy one be replaced by something. We wouldn't have said, no, it can't go anywhere, but
yeah.
We would have liked to seen it replaced.
Okay.
And I think, you know, one of the takeaways for me anyways is, you know, we want to inform all these folks that are doing the tree work in the town that, you know, we're not here to say, absolutely not, that's not the point. It's that they need to let their clients know that they may need to get, you know, some kind of a permit.
Sure.
And the best way to do that is you can go on our GIS, you know, Town of Reading, and take a look and see if there are any wetlands. We have a wetlands layer.
Mm-hmm.
See if the wetlands might looked like they're close to your property, and or call our administrator, Chuck Tarone. So we are going to ask Mr. Costello to come in, and I've talked to him one-to-one and given him all of the paperwork, you know, our tree replacement policy, our minor permit application, and a request for determination of applicability as well.
Sorry to interrupt. Just as a little add-on, the GIS is a good place to start as a first pass. It's not 100% accurate. Don't take it as the gold standard of definitely where the wetlands are or aren't, because in some places in town it's spot on, in some places of town it's off by
lots.
tens of feet.
Okay.
To maybe even 100 feet.
What is GIS?
Geographic Information System.
Okay.
It's a mapping.
Town mapping system. You
okay,
can get to it on the town website.
Well, I wasn't not familiar, so.
Yeah.
So what's the so I understand the fee. Are you asking me to come up? I have no problem with paying the permit fee, obviously, around. What's the fund you mentioned?
It's a tree replacement fund.
Sure.
You can donate to that, or you can plant a tree,
okay.
A native tree on your property.
Or some shrubs.
Or shrubs, and you would talk to Chuck Tarone.
All right, so I won't be resolving it tonight. I have to talk to Chuck, and we'll get this out.
Yeah.
With him. Okay.
Yeah. So, you know, we don't, and we could fine you, but we didn't think that was a good. Well, I mean, this is the first time, and we understand that, you know, your wetlands are a little ways down the hill, and you might not have known that they were there, and I don't think you knew about, you know, our permits and our processes.
Yeah, honestly, I thought Dave was the guy to tell me that, to be honest, because, you know, I'm not, you know, an arborist or anything, so when somebody, you know, I was like, hey, is this all cool? And he's like, yeah, you're good to go. You know, we'll show up this time, and, you know, I was surprised to get the letter to go.
Yeah, I'm sure. And, you know, there are some of our tree people that get it, and you know, they, as a general rule, they just call Chuck up and say, hey, you know, we're working at so-and-so street. What do you think?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay, fair enough.
Appreciate it.
Yeah.
So do we need to make a motion to resolve the enforcement, or it sounds like we've resolved a solution, right?
I don't think we can take the enforcement off until, you know, Chuck and you, Mr. Marotta, talk and figure out what, you know, is the best course of action for you.
Sure.
But it's not, I don't think it's that onerous.
Okay, fair enough.
Yes, talk to Chuck, we'll let him know, obviously, that what we discussed, but it's going to be exactly what we would have asked for if you had come in.
Fair enough.
And if you want to look it up on the website before you talk to Chuck, the tree policy is on the website. See, it's not that long a document, two pages, and
there's a nice easy table on at the end.
It's really easy.
I'll scan the table.
It's really easy. It's going to say either plant a native dogwood or put in some blueberry bushes.
Okay,
that's what it's going to say.
So you could do that as a prep before you talk to Chuck.
Right.
And that way, because he's just going to say what's on that policy, and yeah, so. Once
so
we hear from
him. What are you telling him? Just tell him this is what I want to do to resolve.
Yeah, I mean, it's up to you what you want to do.
You have some flexibility there,
right,
in what your options are. So look at the tree policy, see what works, you think would work well, talk to Chuck about it, and he'll get back to us by the next meeting.
Okay, fair enough.
All right.
All right, great.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for coming in.
Thanks for coming down.
No problem. Have a good night.
Thank
you.
Too.
Candy. Candy.
All right, so do we have anything else on the agenda?
I'm
thinking, no.
We don't have.
This is scant. We don't have minutes.
We don't have any
minutes. We don't have an administrator's report.
Nope. We had no site visits.
So
no bills.
Do you think we'll have site visits this coming weekend? Yeah.
No, because it's the 9th,
be until then,
and so
that's right.
It would be in 2 weeks.
Yeah, you're right.
Why? What's your schedule?
I was just really excited about going every week. Just kind of getting in the routine. I actually really enjoy getting up and going walk around with you guys. It's fun.
It actually is fun. I laugh a lot. I laugh more when I go from the meetings. Oh, well. All right.
So why don't I see what the hours of daylight are around the 9th?
Yeah,
and
daylight
we can
savings
figure out
changes on the 6th.
You can't do Mondays. I mean Sundays, can you?
It's funny. The last couple, I would have been able to do like this past one if we had one. The last couple I have, I know I can't do the one coming up.
Mm-hmm.
The 6th.
Yeah. And I'm sorry, I've been so missing.
Oh, that was good.
Randall Road's gonna require a little bit of time.
It is.
Well, Randall Road's gonna require time, and Low Meadow
Acadia,
is gonna be on that.
Is that coming in by the next meeting? Do you think?
They weren't
maybe
ready this time.
That's gonna be our December meeting, isn't it?
You're
gonna want to do it by the end of the year, and they're gonna want a permit right away.
Yeah.
Just a guess.
They want what they want.
All right, sunlight, daylight. So, by late December, the sunset's going to be 5:45. Okay, August, November, December, sorry.
On Tuesdays, you can come in the afternoon. Right.
Yeah, I can get out of work.
I can.
It's easier for me to get out of work than it is for me
to get out of bed.
The other, no, it's the other boss that usually has something planned on the weekend. That,
if I have enough notice, I can plan to get out of work early to, or work from home that day. Scoot out a little early to go do some site visits.
And to be honest, if Randall Road is marked out, I can get out there and see it. I mean, that's
right.
It's a site we know well enough.
Yeah.
It's,
right.
Thank you for clarifying my concern that I was having with the same thing with the drainage.
You're welcome.
But so I think we can see what
weird
we see there. We'll and then I don't know, we'll see how much other. I see that the site visits are going to add up. It's going to be a pretty long site visit.
Yeah.
For that meeting.
Yep.
Well, so far we just have Acadia and Randall, right?
If Katie comes in,
we're getting
too
something. Now, Kylie, I'm not too worried about.
Okay.
They're getting.
That's pretty much hashed out.
They're getting there, and there is something coming up on Lowell Street.
Oh, is it
a four lot subdivision?
No, the one you're talking about.
Is that the one that they came before us?
Up by Willow and Grove Street.
That's the one in the, I think I know what you're talking about, because there's only room for one thing back there.
And there's something that I guess the consultant wants to diminish our fee because he feels that some of the lots, you know, not all the structures are, you know, well within our jurisdiction, but I think some things are. So, but that's not how we do that.
No.
So, Chuck tried to convey that to him.
All right. Well.
And then, will we have a? Are they going to ask for artists soon? Or are we going to have to do a?
Can you give me an update? The fence was within 25 feet. How did that get resolved?
Oh, and
did
Chuck
it get
had
moved?
Wanted us to go. I'll go look and see the grass on the other side of the fence. I didn't do that.
He went out this week, I think, at 11 on Tuesday or something.
I don't
like
know.
Like that.
We didn't talk.
Were you here for that discussion?
No, I saw the email.
I think that was last week.
Yeah.
No,
so they put the fence in the wrong place. And it's in the 25-foot zone.
Yeah.
And
they were going
to remove it,
right?
They subsequently moved it, right, to where it was supposed to be, but they left the zone of natural vegetation or whatever it is on the other side of the fence. No
different area.
The downhill side?
I thought this was a different area that
No, they sodded it.
They
remember
sodded
it?
They sodded it.
And they need to replant with wetlands vegetation.
I think so.
Okay.
Something.
Buffers.
Yeah.
Vegetation. All right.
of us here.
Are we done? If we're done.
We're done.
Make a motion to adjourn.
I'll second.
All in favor?
No, I'm not ready to leave.
You don't vote, but it just can't happen then.
We just have to stay.
You can't get a quorum on that vote.
Bureaucratic limbo for the rest of your life.
The ultimate stalemate, huh? Just don't vote on the journey.
Oh, hey, Mac.
Who seconded? I'm sorry.
I did. Anything Mike motioned, seconded.